Welcome back. So let's get back into the topic at hand. The YouTube bots.
Yes.
Us YouTubers, we love them. We hate them.
We know nothing about them.
We mildly dislike them.
That's done.
What's your take? Since you're not really a YouTuber, yeah, and you hear people...
The first... Well, it's not my first YouTube video. Believe it or not, I did some really, really bad videos before.
Okay.
On an old, old account, believe me. That's long gone now. But... Broad spectrum, they're not the greatest.
Mm-hmm.
They focus too much on the wrong areas.
Yeah.
Hurt big time the smaller YouTubers.
Mm-hmm.
The people that depend on this way of life.
Yeah. People who quit their jobs.
But that is more to do with copyright than the bots. And then...
Well, the bots, they can detect copyright.
Yeah. But then... They target the wrong things.
Mm-hmm.
They target the... They're hurtful towards the smaller YouTubers.
Yeah.
And they go too much basically based off the companies.
Well, the companies are what
make
YouTube the money. YouTube, they have to take a cut of ad revenue, so...
Essentially, this boils down to copyright law, which we'll get into in a future episode. Possibly the episode the week after next week.
Boy, we got a lot of talk about copyright
here. Yeah, we do. That may or may not be a tumor. So essentially what needs to happen is the bots need to focus more in on the bad channels.
Mm-hmm.
The channels that are promoting whatever.
Yeah.
For the wrong reasons. And not the channels that genuinely want to do something good for their community, the part of YouTube that they belong to.
Yeah.
So, but then the question becomes, how do they find that out? Do they go through every video that that channel has and weed out the content that might be explicitly abusive or neglectful?
Well, that's what the bots are there for.
Which they don't do a very good job at, unless the community gets involved.
Yeah.
But,
and they appeal to a person who can then reverse the age restriction, reverse the copyright claim on the video.
Specific, I actually have an example of this, believe it or not.
Yeah.
There's this Minecraft YouTuber that I know.
Yeah.
Who several years ago got his account deleted. He apparently got 3 strikes on a video.
Mm-hmm.
3 copyright strikes on videos.
3 copyright strikes.
Deleted. So he had, for like a good couple hours, his channel was gone. And he didn't even notice when they deleted it. He just woke up to an email one morning saying that your channel is deleted. So he actually made a video about it and basically said, I felt so bad for the people that clicked on the channel. I couldn't do it. The fans that liked his content.
Yeah.
That wanted to check out his channel and wanted to subscribe to his channel. They couldn't because the channel no longer existed.
There's this movie review channel, it's kind of big, called I Hate Everything.
Yeah.
He reviewed this movie called Cool Cat Saves the Kids. It's an awful movie.
Yeah.
It is basically a 45-minute video, a 15-minute video, and then another like 10-minute video to stretch it out past the 60-minute to call it a movie. So I Hate Everything. He was so strict on this video to the fact where the creator, Derek Savage. You know who Derek Savage is.
I've heard the name before, I don't know.
He's a filmmaker, and I put air quotes, that lives in Nevada.
Is that the one that kept copywriting someone?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
He gave I Hate Everything two copyright strikes. Basically holding his channel hostage. And only because he got the channel back because he had a big enough channel. And he was able to notify YouTube about this situation.
But back to what I was saying before real quick.
Yeah.
When the community gets involved in a situation like that, it's mm-hmm. too late. The abuse has already happened. The channel's already taken off.
Yeah.
It's down to YouTube to now say, to now make it harder, specifically on those channels. The channels that focus upon potentially harmful content.
Yeah.
But then then it comes down to how hard do they make it and how do they know?
Mm-hmm.
Do they hire someone to comb through every potentially harmful channel? Could be every channel on the internet, on YouTube.
Yeah.
Well, by the time it reaches YouTube's attention, it's too late.
Laugh about.
Because that's the time the community gets
everybody
involved.
That was hanging out.
So
now you don't.
They need to make it specifically
so
part. They need to restrict
now you don't.
More videos like that. More of the harmful videos.
About having to be scrounging for your next meal.
The videos that are less harmful, that are more. They more challenge the ideas that the kids were raised to have.
Yeah. And I Hate Everything, the review channel. It was. Fell under fair use. So
no direction home.
The review it was
like
heavily
unknown.
Criticizing that movie, quote unquote movie.
Like
cough, cough.
A
cough,
and
cough, movie, cough, cough.
He was well within his rights to use that copyrighted content. But Derek Savage didn't see it that way. You know how Derek Savage saw copyright? So let's say,
used to win.
Well, how can I explain this?
What are you trying to explain?
Compromise
if
with a mystery tramp, but now you
I'm holding a Coca-Cola cup
yeah.
in my hand.
He's not selling any.
If the Coca-Cola cup was in a shot and the logo was
the vacuum
visible
of his eyes,
then according to Derek Savage,
do you want to
we just hit the 10 minute
make
mark.
A deal.
So let's make it 15 minutes.
How does it feel?
According to Derek Savage, Coca-Cola has a right to your video.
How does it feel?
No matter if
to be
you're criticizing Coke, saying, oh, I hate Coke. Coke
no
so terrible.
Home.
It's so awful. Doesn't matter, because in Derek Savage's eyes,
they have
fair use doesn't exist.
Yeah.
So
they need, they also need to control people like Derek, and make sure that he doesn't go on a spree.
Harmful broadly. So like, this is another topic that I want to kind of get into in another video.
Yeah.
Later, really, really later on.
Or another episode.
Or another episode. Yeah, another episode. After we start getting into the Disney stuff, but.
And we get better equipment.
Yeah, and our camera doesn't die on us.
Yeah, our camera doesn't die on us. Like, almost most of the way through a first. Half
first
of this.
Half of this, and our computer doesn't die.
Well, our computer is fine.
Yeah.
It just wasn't
working.
The charger wasn't working.
But once again, the problem is with YouTube.
Yeah.
YouTube becomes so afraid of what the content creators are putting out that they end up harming the content creators. They put more restrictions on the good type of videos, the videos that challenge existing opinions.
Yeah.
This is coming from someone who is very opinionated about some movies. Some movies that are famously bad movies.
Mm-hmm. No, I don't think you've seen.
I haven't seen a lot of like really bad movies. Maybe Avatar. But that's.
I haven't.
That's
well,
bad, bad.
Pause it.
No.
And
once you pause it.
We'll be right back. Sorry about that, we're back. There was a little bit of difficulties at home. Anyways, back to the bots situation. So, bots are bad.
Yes.
They
need a major refocusing.
They need to control the people.
Bad people.
Yeah.
The people that either intentionally want to cause harm or are intentionally causing harm before the community or their viewers bring it up to them. Because then by that time it's become a pattern and people have caught on to it and people have are having a problem with it and it becomes... And then it starts into this big shebang where other YouTubers get involved.
Mm-hmm.
And it starts getting further and further away from the problem.
Yeah.
Like your mama and yourself.
Is
you don't know how to read or write, there's no books
YouTube and the bots that YouTube and your owns
knows no limit.
Need to crack and down on like the channels lawn. Before they get this back.
Your heart is like the ocean, mysterious
before
and
they
dark.
Get into the realm of child abuse.
One more cup of coffee for
so it's. That question becomes, how far are the bots allowed to go? Are they allowed to go all the way and completely remove the channel? Or do they just do... Or do they... I feel like the only way is for them to just completely remove the channel.
Yeah.
Make it irrefutable because... It wouldn't fall under
fair use.
It wouldn't fall under
the community guidelines.
It wouldn't fall under any other reason that they could come up with.
Mm-hmm.
Because then YouTube can say, we know that what you're doing is wrong because in your videos you do X, Y, and Z.
Yeah.
Because you show these aspects of your life.
Mm-hmm.
Now the prank genre on YouTube is another problem. Focusing back onto Jake Paul. The worst offender of this.
Ah, I hate
Jake
Paul.
Got arrested. What was it? A year ago? Two years ago?
A year ago.
For noise complaints.
Well, no, that was a long time ago.
He actually
got
arrested.
He got raided at his house in Calabasas because he was holding, like, he had some illegal guns there. So he was raided by the FBI.
I know he did another, like, hide-and-seek raid video with another YouTuber.
Mm-hmm.
But that's not really related. So... Pranks can go far. Really, really far.
Yeah.
And can get really harmful.
Yeah.
Specifically, there's an episode about, from Bizarre Bark.
Bizarre Bark was the Disney Channel
show that Jake Paul
was on. But Jake Paul was fired and then the show got canceled.
There's an episode specifically focusing on a prankster who uses his pranks to take down other channels.
Mm-hmm.
Really harmful prank stuff like that.
Okay.
So
I'll be here.
And that gets uploaded to the internet.
Yeah.
And you know the saying about the internet.
Once it's
there forever.
Yeah.
No matter how many copyrights you claim. So. So it's not just the children channels, stuff like that. Family channels, prank channels, channels like that, channels that could become potentially harmful to the people that watch them or the people that are affected by them.
Yeah.
And there aren't channels that aren't bad channels, like Mr. Beast. Guy who literally loses money every month because he gives so much away.
Mr. Beast makes videos
literally
giving
away cars.
Money, cars, anything
iPads.
Of monetary value to
he's giving
random
away
people.
Switches, he's giving away PS5s, he's giving away.
And he makes millions of dollars doing this too.
He makes money primarily from
his merch?
His merch, because if you look at his YouTube analytics,
mm-hmm.
his the money he actually makes from videos go down.
Yeah.
So, I know he's not the only YouTuber like this.
Mm-hmm.
Like, there's another YouTuber that I don't know if you know, ZHC.
I don't know.
He's basically this art-related YouTuber who customizes everything that he buys and gives it away.
Yeah.
Like, he does challenges.
Mm-hmm.
So he bought 4 Lamborghinis, had his customization team spend like 2 days completely customizing them. And the last team that drops out he brings in his viewers.
Yeah.
And he gave them a Lamborghini fully customized. And several $1,000.
Okay.
He's customized tablets. He's customized Switches. I think he's also done PS5s. He's done, I think, laptops. He's customized schools.
Mm-hmm.
He's done hospitals. He's done a bunch of stuff.
Yeah.
So it's not like every YouTuber that may be related to children or may be related to certain topics, it's bad.
Yeah.
Jake Paul is an example of, in my opinion, one of the worst content creators there is. It's purely out there for the money. Especially since he's now gotten into his old boxing thing.
Well,
and music.
Yeah, he's just stick to boxing. Okay, so real quick,
yeah.
We're kind of running low on time.
Yeah.
So we wanted to do this. We wanted to talk about some of our favorite video games. So, what's your favorite video game on the PlayStation?
Right now, it's actually a pop.
Okay.
Graphically, my favorite game would either be Jedi Fallen Order or Spider-Man Miles Morales.
And why is that?
Graphics. The graphics in both games are truly stunning. It's one of the best game creators you could get right now.
Yeah.
Especially with owning Insomniac.
Sony now owns Insomniac.
Yeah. And there's more elements to the game that I really do enjoy.
Mm-hmm.
Since Miles Morales' story focuses... There are similar topics. Miles Morales' story focuses more on the loss of a loved one.
Yeah.
Specifically through Miles and Finn. The writing in Miles Morales.
Oh my god. It's so good.
I love the fact that Miles and Finn were first written as friends.
Mm-hmm.
That's why Finn could never kill Miles.
Yeah.
That's why when she threatened to, all he did was lift up the mask. And she stopped. And even in the scenes when they're on opposite sides, like the scene at Trinity Church before Rhino attacks, they're obviously friends before enemies. That's what I love. Finn is the version of Miles where it's like, what if Peter Parker never got involved? What if he was never introduced to Feast? And what if he never met Spider-Man?
Okay. Anything else? I'm giving you like 10 seconds.
Jumping over to Fallen Order. Give you the quick like summary of it. Basically, it follows...
Time's up.
Come on.
Mine...
Let me get a big fever first.
Okay.
Because this won't take time.
I'm just playing with it.
It's specific... Fallen Order specifically focuses on the effects of Order 66. specifically through the main character, Cal, and his mentor, his mentor in the game,
yeah.
Seer, and their guilt over what happens because of Arkham Order 66. Cal, who loses his mentor right in front of him, basically swears against the Jedi. A Padawan in training who loses his master, his lightsaber is damaged, and is now basically scarred for the rest of his life. And he swears against the Jedi. He believes himself to be unworthy.
Okay, I'm gonna cut you off before you go too deep into spoilers.
There's not that much more spoiler I think yet. Aside from the basic, Seer is the mentor who lost her paddle. You don't really know that much about the paddle.
My favorite video game would have to be
The Last of Us.
I can't stop talking about it in our private conversations. Yeah. Basically, it's this zombie survival game where you have to take this girl, Ellie, who's named Ellie, across the country to find this, to find a malicious headquarters so that she could reproduce the cure to the zombie virus. And along the way, you kind of develop this father-daughter relationship with her, because she's an orphan and your daughter dies at the beginning of the game. And it's a nice slow game, although the jump scares are intense. You don't know who or what is gonna kill you. It could be a enemy militia or a zombie. That's basically the entire story. The ending made me cry. Any last things? We got about 30 seconds left.
The only other game that I think is really worth mentioning might be Uncharted.
Okay, that's it.
Yeah.
You don't have enough time.
So,
this was fun. We should do this more often. We'll try to get episodes like this out every week. This has been the Hallows at Noon. Thanks for listening.
Thank you for listening to this very special episode of The Hallows at Noon. We will be back soon.